stood? Did a lot of new people. Jerry, do you want to explain where this stood?
If you're over on when you go on Elm Street, just in a ways on the left, there's a space there with archery, and that's where it was.
Right next to, well, across what was a street, from Hanscom Hall, right?
Mm-hmm. And it faced High Street, which used to go up through to Church Street.
Only building ever built in the Romanesque Revival style in Bethel. And only about one of five in Oxford County.
Look at the common, how pretty it was once. This report down to a reasonable length, but I found so many interesting items, at least to me, that quite possibly you'll all feel it is much too long. If so, I'm sorry. Some of this information was taken from cards here at the Historical Society, but a great deal was obtained from a collection of old town reports that Stanley collected some time ago and had bound. I know many of you are aware how much more interesting they used to be with marriages, births, and deaths, as well as other items of interest. I just made myself read only about the schools, but Rodney had a great time reading them much more closely and conveying interesting parts to me. This is the 100th anniversary of this wonderful building, where so many of us spent some happy years. Some spent 8 years here, and others only 4. It closed for the last time in the early 50s. In the town report of 1894 and 95, a brick school was being built which would eliminate 2 houses. The town paid J.M. Philbrook for the lot, $800, paid H. Purington and Company per contract, $10,400. They paid extra for the slate roof, $300. Paid for slate, $170. And I don't understand what this is all about, but it paid for the attic floor, $20. cementing the cellar, labor, cement, extra, $115. For gridding, turf, grass seed, and a team, $82.09. Plumbing and lumber, $522.70. Furnaces and brick, $325. The architect was Mr. F.A. Thompson. $375. Steps, labor, and so forth, $29.90. Desks, Paris Manufacturing Company and Charles Davis for trucking, $610.09. General expenses, $35.07. Sidewalks, $120.50. Total expenses, $13,916.96. The total appropriated was $13,120. From the sale of the two schoolhouses, one on Broad Street, $450, and one on Mechanic Street, $400. So it helps a little on that deficit. Schools as of 1893 and 1894 was a grammar school, upper primary, lower primary, West Bethel, East Bethel, Swan's Common, W.W. Mason's, Middle Intervale, Dean's Ferry, the Upper North Side, Foster's, one by Sanborn Brook in Middle Intervale, one where Bobby Blake lives, one at the top of the hill before the East Bethel Church, one near Pine Woods, the Steam Mill, Walker's Mill, Half Goods, the Flat, Chandler Hill, Grover Hill, Bird Hill, Mill Hill. And I'm sure there's others. In 1897, the total school fund was $3,793.35. And all eight grades were in the brick school, which contained four rooms. The town paid W.W. Hastings for repairs caused by freezing water in the winter of 1897, $30. They paid Gilbert Toole for double windows, $18.74. In 1899, the money raised for the town was $2,000. They received from state school and mill tax $1,246, and received from Gilead for tuition $30, received from Milton for tuition $60, and paid the janitor $25.23. The amount available from 1899 was $3,699.03. The amount expended for teachers was $2,625.95. And for janitors, fuel and transportation, $3,687.02. And for textbooks, $300. There were 10 schools maintained this time. At the New Brick School, there were complaints about the heat and cold and damp weather, and it was suggested that the system needs to be changed. So said H.H. Hastings, superintendent. A new piano was delivered on May 1899. It was a Bear Brothers model and almost brand new. A play was put on at Odeon Hall to supplement the $90 already raised. In 1902, the salary for the superintendent was $145. It said the brick school building needs attention badly to the plumbing and the heating is very unsatisfactory. It was recommended to put a new system in. In 1903, there were repairs for the brick school. The furnace was thoroughly overhauled and cold air boxes put in. Registers were cut down and lowered to the floor. This helped to keep the rooms warm enough. There were two salaries annually, less than $250, six others less than $300, and one more than the average, $356.52. There was a new law enacted by the state legislature that if the town does not have a high school, the town must pay for the pupils to go where there is one. Bethel Grammar School held its first graduation exercise ever on June 26, 1903. On January 11, 1905, it was decided to use a chaff factory whistle to signal no school when inclement weather hits the Bethel area. One long and three short blasts at 8 a.m. In 1904, the annual school fund was $3,995.50. In 1908, the Brick Grammar School held its first track meet. Events included a 50-yard dash, a 100-yard dash, a 440-yard run, a half-mile run, a potato race, and a long and a high jump. H.H. Hastings' salary was $125 a year, since they'd gone down $20. On April 20th, 1911, Arthur Herrick, Mildred Hapgood, and Gwendolyn Stearns were the new teachers at the Brick School. Herrick was Barbara Brown's father, and she told me that he was a principal. And Mildred Hapwood married Harry Lyon, and they were Elizabeth Lyon Bain's parents. E.L. Callahan was a superintendent, and his salary was $116.67, and you see, it's still going down. On June 24, 1915, Frank H. Byram of Freeport was named superintendent. In 1914, Gwen Stern's salary was for the winter term $13.50, and spring term it was $13.50. And the salary for 81 teachers was $3,727.80. There were two salaries annually of less than $250, six others less than $300, and one more than average, $356.52. On February 3rd, the first PTA was formed with the president, James S. Hutchins, vice president, Maud L. Thurston, secretary and treasurer, Alice M. Lane, social committee, Mrs. Eddie Van, legislature, Ellery C. Park, education, Frankie Henston, school improvement, Mrs. Dana C. Philbrook, press committee, Nellie Whitmore. W.E. Ben Skoda was appointed superintendent on August 30th, 1917. He was a Harvard graduate. On March 28, 1918, it was announced that a manual training program for the 7th and 8th grades was being instituted at the local school. Charles L. Pollard donated tools and agreed to instruct two afternoons a week. Teachers as of September 5th, 1918 were Edna Bartlett, Alice Cross, Evangeline Atherton, Ethel J. Philbrick, Harriet Saunders, F. Ethel Weber, Naomi Smith, Ismay Jackson Hathaway, Myrtle Wilson, Eva Bartlett, Mary Morse, and Marion Frost. A basketball team was organized on February 20th, 1919, and the captain was Rodney Bartlett, and the coach was Louis Vane. On March 4th, 1920, Charles E. Lord finished his tenure as superintendent and moved to Portland. On April 22, 1920, Francis E. Russell was chosen superintendent. He was from Bridgeton and had attended Colby College. Teachers as of August 26, 1920 were Lillian B. Cochran, who became Lillian Bartlett of East Bethel, Annette L. Austin, Ethel J. Philbert, Mrs. Bisbee, Peter L. Thurston, Laura Cummings, Molly C. Stanley, my aunt, Myrtle Beckler, Ruth Cole was Barbara Moncala's mother, Agnes M. Dearden, Lillian Doughty, Mary L. Grover, Gwendolyn Godwin, who became Holt, Libby L. Goodridge, who became Nealon, Myrtle Wilson, Bertha M. Packard, Claire Mason, became Smith, Alice Spiller, Myrtle Hayes, June Tracy, and Marjorie Jordan. On August 11, 1921, in the grammar school was Edna M. Bartlett. She was from East Bethel. The intermediate was Lillian D. Coughlin, Babe's mother. The second primary was Lucy C. Whitten, and in the first primary was Ethel J. Filbert. On November 17, 1921, the PTA officers were President F. E. Russell, First Vice President Alonzo F. Chapman, Second Vice President Carrie White, Secretary Ethel Philbert, Treasurer Agnes Quattle, Educational Committee Frank B. Hanscom, Legislative Committee Henry H. Hastings, Finance Committee Herbert Rowe, Rowe Chapman's father, Press Phil Tibbetts, Margaret Tibbetts' mother, and Entertainment Mrs. Eddie Bain. On February 23, 1922, Marion T. Gehring appealed in an open letter in the Citizen for the townspeople to raise money for recreation building near the grammar school as a place for the children to play in the winter and during inclement weather, and we still don't have one. The grammar school organized a baseball team on May 11, 1922. Two games had been played against the Walker's Mills team, and one was scheduled with the Gould freshmen. Kenneth Stanley was a manager, that was my brother. Edward O'Day was captain, and the players were Gordon and Everett separate from the brick building. 3, appoint a subcommittee to investigate possible sites and costs. On March 19, 1925, a 1 acre of land was purchased at Clarence Fox. The committee decided on a 1-story building, 48 feet by 75 feet, consisting of 4 rooms, and the cost of $16,500 was voted to be paid off at $3,000 per year. The building committee was Henry Hastings, Frank Russell, Wade Thurston, and John Burbank. On January 30, 1927, Frank E. Russell was re-elected for a salary of $2,400 a year. He retired in 1929 after 35 years in education. On June 30, 1929, E.R. Bowden of Lubeck, Maine was named superintendent. On May 11, 1931, students chosen for a spelling bee for semifinals for Oxford County was held in Rumford with students Ruby Jodry, Beatrice Merrill, Doris Dunsmore, Rosalind Rowe, Barbara Moore, Margaret Tibbetts, Geraldine Stanley, Helen Krause, Eileen Greenley, and Helen Lowe. And I would have won my class if I had spelled, or took too long spelling accommodation. And let me tell you, I still remember how to spell it. In 1931, the cost of education per pupil was $55. And there were 88 conveyed. Salaries were low as $16 per week, the highest of $29. Teachers of July 16, 1931, were Herbert R. Dean for the 8th grade, Olive Lurvy for the 7th, Jenny Mann for the 6th, and Lecter Chapin for the 5th. On September 31st, the PTA officers were President Carl Brown, Vice President E.R. Clinton, Secretary Alma Thurston, Treasurer Alice Ballard, Executive Committee Percy Brink, Alice Rowe, Kyle Brown, and Alma Thurston, and Ethel Bisbee. Press agent, Phil Tibbetts. In 1932, the roof had begun to leak, and electric lights had been placed over the stairs. Salaries were reduced 10% and will be reduced 20%. This was because of the Depression. In 1934, there was the largest registration in years, 370, and new blackboards are needed in the 8th grade room. May 24, 1934, the honor students at graduation were John King, Talbot Crane, Royden Kitty, Helen Krause, Edward Robertson, and Ethel Jodry. Herbert R. Bean was still principal. Student names on the program in 1935 were Helen Lowe, Eileen Greenleaf, Mary Thurston, Maynard Austin, Kathleen White, Barbara Hall, Mary Clough, Dana Brooks, Parker Brown, and Rodney Eames. I found no list of honor students only. In 1936, Mr. E.C. Naughton was hired as principal after Herbert Bean, who retired after 6 years. He went to Old Orchard to be principal later. Repairs were made to the roof at this time. In 1936, Carrie White was hired for superintendent at a salary of $2,400. In her report, she gave a tribute to the janitor, Harry Sowen. She mentioned how he went beyond his duties to make repairs and so forth, besides tending the furnaces. He was a wonderful man. Honor parts on May 27, 1936 were Madeline Bird, Catherine Davis, Eva Bashaw, Virginia Davis, Margaret Vail, Lee Hutchins, Alan Pratt, Earl Palmer Jr. Special music was Sidney Howe. Marshall was Clayton Crockett from grade 7. President of the class was Madeline Bird. Vice President was Lee Hutchins. Secretary and Treasurer was Irving Brown. On June 3, 1937, Carrie White was again hired at a salary of $2,400. Half paid by the state, $600 by Bethel, $60 by Gilead, $260 by Greenwood, $100 by Upton and $180 by Newry. Honor parts on June 10, 1937 with Jane Addams, Robert Perry, Natalie Foster, Mary Jodry, Barbara Luxton, Clayton Crockett, William Layton, Robert Lowe, Fillmore Clough, Muriel Hall. Teachers as of August 12, 1937 were J. Oman Drummond, Gwen Stearns, Helen Starling, Millie Williams, Alice Bell. Tucker, Maxine Clark, Ethel Ward, Calista Morgan, Dyson Davis, Belmore Cole, Olive Lurby, Bailey Hinkley, Ruby Bennett, Eleanor Buck, Louie P. Coffin, Edna Kemp, Hazel and Maude Sauls, Dorothy Edwards, and Hazel Grover. That doesn't mean the grammar school means all over. In 1938, honor students were Rosalie George, Henry Robertson, Elizabeth Gorman, Carla Smith, and Muriel Dean. As we know, Muriel Dean Butters. October 20th, 1938, the Grammar School Orchestra consisted of violinists Ida Clark, Robert Greenleaf, and Lyndall Nevins. Trumpets was Gilbert LeClaire and Carol Robertson, who later married. Saxophone, Stanley Davis. Drums, Raymond Winston. In 1940, the average salary for men teachers was, per week, $26.19. For women per week, $19.19, and for the janitor, $18. At this time, the superintendent's office was enlarged and a fireproof cabinet purchased. Dr. Harry Wilson was a health officer for 345 pupils. This was in 1941. In 1942, there was a loss of teachers because of the war, and manpower shortage caused late delivery of wood. In 1943, the old fence was repaired, and a new fence on High Street was installed. This was the year the hot lunch program was established, sponsored by the PTA. On June 10, 1943, the Bethel District pupils were reported to have raised over $7,000 in war bonds and stamps. A Jeep certificate was presented to the Bethel Grammar School. On January 13, 1944, Ruth Davis resigned as a fifth grade teacher. Mrs. Ruth Hastings was hired to replace her. As a result of consultation, Gould Academy teachers were taught music and physical education to the 7th and 8th grammar school pupils. Teachers were Joe Roderick and Miss Newman. Joe also coached boys' seasonal sports and without expense to the town. On March 21, 1946, Carrie White resigned after being superintendent for 10 years. And on June 13, 1946, Donald M. Christie was named superintendent. They raised $10,000 worth of war bonds and stamps and were purchased during the year, and 15 tons of paper was collected. In 1946, the grammar school, with a prospect of 55 in one room, and over 40 and all the others, will be badly crowded the next few years. An upper grade building should be built. This is the start of this wonderful building's demise. The average yearly salary of teachers was $1,319.40. In 1947, quote, "Let us act not delude ourselves with wishful thinking and a get-by attitude. Let's be prepared to meet the situation as it comes," unquote. These words were by Donald Christie's superintendent. On December 11, 1947, Harry T. Sawin, longtime janitor of the village schools, retired after 22 years of service. Paul Salway was hired for the position, and later Bud Payne became janitor. On March 20th, 1948, Donald M. Christie was re-elected at a salary of $4,000 per year. On December 20th, 1948, the basketball team comprised of co-captains Frank Murphy and Kenneth Delano. The players were Albert Taylor, Paul Fawcett, Dennis Wilson, Holly Merrill, Edward Hastings, John Marshall, Richard Littlefield, Warren Hastings, Ronald Baker, Dick Emery, Melvin Olson, Gerald Harrington, Herbert Adams, and Stanley Clark. Class officers in 1949 were President Barbara Cole, Vice President John Marshall, Secretary Dennis Wilson, Treasurer Edward Hastings. The enrollment as of September 8, 1949 was 46 in the 8th grade, 44 in the 7th, 38 in the 6th, and 43 in the 5th. On October 20, 1949, the Survey Committee recommended the 7th and 8th grades be brought to the grammar school. On April 6, 1950, the local school children were given sodium fluoride treatment for their teeth. And Mary Ann Myers was a winner of a district spelling contest on April 20th, 1950. A building committee was formed of consisting of Kimball Ames, Guy Bartlett, Elmer Bennett, Al Brown, Stanley Brown, Philip Chatham, Earl Davis, Richard Davis, June Gregg, Robert Hastings, Olive Head, Arthur Herrick, Jane Nealon, and Burton Newton and Evans Wilson. The committee considered recommending a six-room building, but when a $60,000 offer was made by Gould Academy for the building and land of the grammar school, this was changed to a 10-room building. They recommended it be built on the Crescent grounds. There was 464 pupils, and the teacher's average salary was $1,873. Selling this wonderful building was one of the worst decisions ever made in town. I've never understood why it was done. No doubt it was the money offered, but I feel it was a too hasty decision. It looks to most of us as a waste, as the area isn't used for much, and I never thought we should have given in to Gould Academy and closed High Street. Then I have some stories attached to me. I understand that Phyllis Dock, Raleigh Chapman, Margaret Tibbetts, and Barbara Lucas are called the Frisky Four. Well, I'm Stanley named you, but they meet quite often, and Phil was giving me some, she said that they were all in agreement that Herbert Bean and Olive Levy were fine teachers and very good disciplinarians, and I'm sure those that had them agreed. The Frisky Four started school in the grammar school, but their second, third, and fourth grades were in the new primary school. As one student who was shaken by the hair back and forth across the front of the room and also grabbed by the hair at other times and yanked around, I can assure you she had some kind of discipline. She broke the metal of the seat the Chandler Dalzell was sitting in and left her marks on Viv Berry's throat. I well remember her discipline. It was most interesting to visit the room when Stanley was in her grade to see how she'd changed. I was shocked at the actions of Stanley and Peter Davis and others, and she didn't seem aware. She wasn't the Mrs. Levy, as most of us knew her. Phil, tell some more of her memories. One of my memories from school days was very important to me, that of the practice of the teacher reading to the class 1/2 hour after lunch. Although I can't recall any specific books read to us, they were invariably interesting, and we couldn't wait to learn what happened in the next day's chapter. On transportation to and from school, I honestly can't remember how kids in other outlying areas got to school. I do recall that Harry Brown, who lived in what is now Larry Aston's house on Sunset Road, used to pick us up in the a.m. and p.m. His special treat in winter was when he came for us with his horse and sleigh. This was only on decent days. And she goes on. Before school started, we had to form lines by class and march to our rooms. Any unruly students were soundly reminded that this was a no-no, usually by the use of a switch. May 1st was May basket time, and teachers were the recipients of the goodies. And on Valentine's Day, youngsters brought cards. I believe that we drew names so that each student was remembered. We also had a chance to slip in a Valentine, usually signed Guess Who, from an admirer. Before graduating from grammar school, we had to take state board exams in order to be eligible to enter Gould Academy. I forgot to mention that dancing ballroom instructor came after school once a week to teach us how to waltz and foxtrot. I can't remember if this was free or had a fee. That woman doing it.
Did they do that when you went there?
I don't remember.
No. They did teach. This is Merrill over here in the great Karen Merrill. But I don't think
didn't come in school. To school.
No. We have Farah taught later.
Yeah.
When my sister was
school. Oh, yeah. During these school years, there were other activities which remain as strong or stronger in my memory than some of the academics. The local dentist provided posters with blanks of dates so we could mark each day that we brushed our teeth according to his instructions. These dates were marked with stars, which he also provided. Another activity which was promoted from the Bethel Savings Bank was that of learning to save money. Each week, a cashier from the bank came to school to collect the packets with individual savings by each child. Even if the total savings for that week was only 5 cents, it was duly recorded and put in the child's savings account. Another popular activity each spring was that of seeing who could bring to class the first mayflower, wild violet, and so forth. It introduced us to nature's gifts. A special treat was when someone found a lady's slipper. There were fences around the school ground. At recess, the boys played on the upper side towards Church Street of the school and the girls on the lower side. On rainy days, we had to play in the basement. In the winter time, we sometimes went sliding down High Street, which obviously was not heavily traveled as it is now. Those living outside of town and some who lived nearby brought lunches which we ate downstairs and later in the eighth grade room with Harry Solomon, the school janitor, as our supervisor. Other items of interest were told to me. James Smith Mills said that her class was the last class of the Bethel Grammar School. And Margaret Bennett Baker told Mary Payne that all the bricks from the demolition of the grammar school were dumped under what is now the mall below the railroad tracks. Mary also told me that Mr. Christie gave Bud the wheelbarrow that was used to carry coal to the furnace. Julia Brown told me that Myra Wheeler, who entered into deviltry quite often, was one time punished by shutting her in the closet. One time while there, she ate the teacher's lunch. When her father, Wesley Wheeler, was called to the school and the matter discussed, Myra said, "You know, you told me if I was shut in the closet again to eat the teacher's lunch." Any comments from anybody that wants to add something to this? I know you'd like to comment on the teacher's salary, Dawn.
No, they were still okay, but
yeah.
I'll make a comment. All of the bricks weren't done down there. I built a house in about 1955 at the end of the road, and most of the bricks
came across, and we said they certainly can't be red.
That's a great meeting.
It's the high school. It's high school seniors at part of Brick Grammar School. High school seniors at the front of Brick Grammar School.
That big?
High school seniors. Go to Academy, too.
Oh, I see what you mean, all right. How loud would you recognize it? That's Paul Chesney. My brother Fred. My brother Fred.
So what year would that be?
I won't.
Would he be?
Roughly.
That's what it figures?
He was born 1912, so you can figure out what he was then.
Eighteen, maybe?
Eighteen.
I think that's Catherine Herrick. That's a.
That's a girl, I think.
Yeah. Huh?
Looks like that's a girl.
Yeah. I don't know, I thought it looked like a.
Well, that's Marguerite.
Sylvia Merrill.
Marguerite Heath. What was her name?
Barbara Heath.
Barbara Heath, right.
Yeah, I thought that was.
Polly Brown.
Polly, I'm going with that.
Right beside her.
Yeah.
The Frank.
Yeah.
That. A day.
The Brick twins.
Is that Lucia right in the back?
What year would that have been?
How old were these people? Who are you pointing out?
Well, she was about around Roma's age. Would that have been 23, 24?
Well, these people.
24, 35. Because I think that little girl was second from the left in front, is Maureen.
Oh, really?
That looks like.
Yeah, yeah.
I think 23, 24.
Okay.
Isn't that about Paul Doolin?
Paul Doolin?
Yeah.
That's my brother Don.
That's Paul.
Chief of Chapman.
That looks like one's brown, it's on.
On the left, yeah.
These people were born around 1914, then?
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Lynn Whitman?
That Eleanor Brown.
That's a Brown.
Yeah, Eleanor Lyon.
Eleanor Lyon's in that photograph, mother?
Who?
Eleanor Lyon.
Fourth one from the left.
Yeah, right there.
Fourth one from the left, right?
This is Mrs. Bisbee.
Mary Thurston?
Yeah, might be. That's Brother Tim. Now, that looks like a chafing right there in the middle.
Right, this one, right there.
Yes, it is, it is.
Which one, do you know?
Right.
Which chafing?
It's either Electra or, I don't know which one. Winona. It looked like more of Winona, but the age would be near Electra's age. Because that's my brother Henry.
He was born 1907.
Nellie Daddy, isn't that Nellie Joe Green she was? And that's Marion Dean. That's my brother Kenneth.
Yeah, that's a Skillings.
That's a Chase, I have a.
I Donna, Mary Ann Myers, Sheila Mary, Jan Stearns, Mary Nealon, that's a Snyder, and a Clough. That's Carmen, Frank Flint, Ruth Bishop, Nancy Carver, Molly Marshall, that is Alberta Baker. That's a Coulomb, Nellie, and another Clough. Paul Fawcett, Lindy Bartlett, Bobby Blake. That's a Kimball, Robert Curtis, Joan Bennett, Patrick Hall, Skillens, Betty Ann Hastings, Donna Anderson. That's a Paul Walker. Merrill.
Neil Merrill.
No, might be Lee Merrill. That was the teacher, Charles Chapman. I think that was a Waterhouse, Snyder, Lewis Smith, Merrill, David Fleet, Herbie Adams, and Richard Littlefield.
Where were you, babe?
I guess I wasn't there that day.
Dig down something?
It's the, it's one of those in the back.
Don Bennett.
Speak up.
Is one Sonny Hastings?
I don't know, what?
Like the third from the right end?
One Sonny Hastings up there, Mother?
What?
One is Sonny Hastings up there, I don't know.
That one, yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Charlie Smith and Ronnie Kendall always played ball.
That's Ronnie Kendall.
Charlie.
First one, Hobie. That's Hobie.
Yes.
The first one is Ronnie. The second one is Charlie Smith.
Yeah.
What's up, Brendan?
That's Greg Merrill.
No, Neil Merrill.
Neil.
Toby and Ronnie and Charlie Smith.
It's refreshment time, everybody. Refreshments and socializing.